God is good all the time. Well, good morning and welcome to worship here at the First Congregational Church of Saugatuck. It is truly a blessing to have you all gathered here today. Before we jump into our worship service, I do have a few announcements that I would like to share with everyone. First, a thank you to everyone who came to do some yard work yesterday. We got all the garden beds cleared out pretty much, and we worked until we started to get dumped on by rain. But we got a good bit of yard work done yesterday, so thank you so much for lending a hand with that. Also, we have taken down our mask line that ran outside along the steps there, freebie masks for anyone that needed one. We've taken that down now that the tour season is kind of winding down for the year, but we still have some masks available that Cindy has made, and so there is kind of a tray in the back where the hymnals are kept for worship. If you need a mask or know someone that needs one, we'll kind of keep some on hand in case those are needed throughout the off season. But a smaller supply than masking the whole neighborhood, yes. And then we are going to be collecting cake mixes and frostings for the Christian Neighbors Thanksgiving packs. We're going to be collecting those through November 22nd. So you're welcome to bring in your cake mixes anytime between here and now, because I think packing day is the 24th. So just make sure to keep an eye out for good deals on cake mix boxes. And then this Friday evening, we have a not-so-spooky Halloween party happening in our parking lot. We're going to be doing a drive-in movie, and we'll have a campfire and out and for anyone that wants to make us some more. So you're welcome to drive in, and if you're a creative type, you're welcome to costume up. I know that Tim and I have a costume we're doing I'm super excited about. So you're welcome to come over for a movie and just some good fellowship time this Friday evening. And Phyllis, you're holding a microphone, so that suggests to me that you have an announcement too.
In honor of Pastor Appreciation Month, the congregation has a card for you. Another gift will be coming in the mail. You'll have that at your home this week. And for the rest of October, there may be other surprises that happen. But we appreciate all that you've done in all of this different times that we are going through. And your creativity and your passion for this job is amazing. Thank you.
Thank you, Phyllis. Thank you, congregation. It was a nice surprise. Thank you all so very much. Just my last announcement is if you'd like to join us for Bible study on Thursday afternoons, we have a lectio at lunchtime. You bring in your lunch and we'll just have a time of studying God's Word in the fellowship hall. But I think that's all of our announcements. It's kind of a busy fall season. Things are getting up off the ground here, but I think that's it. Oh, no, it's not. There's a flyer in your bulletin for a Tuesday evening discussion group via Zoom for our Heritage Month celebration throughout November. The Congregational Library in Boston, kind of one of our congregational motherships out there, they have put together a wonderful curriculum in celebration of 400 years of the Congregational Way. And so we have a discussion group based on some of our historical documents. And so this is really, if you're a history buff or a Congregational Way buff or wants to know more about our history and where we came from, this would be a great discussion group for you. So we'll get together at 7 o'clock on Zoom for that discussion group. And there is a sign-up sheet right by where Dan is standing there at the welcome table. If you would like to put your name and email address down, I'll make sure you get those Zoom links. Okay, let's all stand together and join our voices in our call to worship. Welcome to the house of God's love.
Praise
Is this the right time? Is God's love available now? God's love is always here, always ready. What about emergencies? What if the system crashes? God's love has been around since the beginning, and it will be here after the ending. We're ready to live in God's love 24/7. And our hymn for the day is Freely, Freely. And just a reminder, we are singing softly or humming along to our hymns these days. But please join me in Freely, Freely. Congregation, please join me in prayer. God, you are God forever. This alone is cause for celebration, but we also know that we are your people. As we feel your love washing over us now, may we love you with every part of our being, heart, mind, body, and soul. We celebrate your love in our lives, and we ask for your help as we try our best to boldly share the good news of your love with others. And God, hear us as we continue to have our hearts united in the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. throughout the month of October, we have been learning how to sign the doxology prayer, both as a way of learning how to pray in a new way during this COVID era, and also as just a new chance to learn a body kind of prayer. And so, by popular demand, we're going to do this twice through for a good practice. And then the kids are going to head off because they have an activity based on the last line of the doxology, which is Father, Son, Holy Ghost. So they're going to be talking about the Trinity today. So let's go ahead and sing and sign our doxology. We'll practice together. So we have praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God, all ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Let's do that one more time. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, Amen. Thank you. So they're going to be talking about the Trinity today. Father, Son, Holy Ghost. And I thought, as a way of kind of kicking off their conversation for our Sunday school time, we might name what we call God. What are the names of God that we use when we're going to go to God in prayer? Anyone have a name that they call God? Father? Amory?
Lord God.
Lord God.
That we are His people and His servants.
Yes, absolutely. A very formal Lord that reminds us that we are God's servants. I like to use Creator because it reminds me that God was here before me and will be long after me, and that I can see God in creation around me. Friend. Very good.
Eternal.
The eternal.
Almighty.
The almighty Jesus.
Counselor.
Counselor. Very good. Any last names that we have for God?
Peacemaker.
Peacemaker. Yes. What a wonderful one. These are names and job titles, it seems like. All right, well, let's bless the kids as they head off downstairs to continue talking about exploring the Trinity.
Good morning. Today's reading is from Matthew chapter 22, verses 34 through 46. It can be found in your bulletin. The greatest commandment, verse 34. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with his question. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself, as the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Whose son is the Messiah? While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, what do you think about the Messiah? Whose son is he? Well, the son of David, they replied. And he said to them, how is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son? No one could say a word in reply, and from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Linda. So this last Tuesday, the Wall Street Journal ran a story with the following headline. How next-door neighbors with opposing political views actually stayed friends. The story was covered by Claire Ansbury, and it began like this. The Mitchells, lifelong Democrats, planted a Joe Biden sign in their front yard in their suburban Pittsburgh home. The Gates family, who lived next door, were lifelong Republicans, and they put a Donald Trump sign in theirs. And another homemade sign stands in each yard that reads, we heart them, with a big yellow arrow pointing towards the other house. And in the middle of each of those hearts, they wrote the words, one nation. There's so much hate, says Chris Mitchell, who came up with the idea. We want to send a message. The message, says both the Mitchell and Gates households, is this. People on opposite ends of the political spectrum can actually like each other and be civil. The question for many Americans, how? Millions of Americans are alarmed at the bitter split in the country, with 9 out of 10 Americans saying incivility is a problem, and 2/3 saying it's a major problem. And this is according to a 2019 poll by public relations firm Weber Shandwick, which was taken, please note, before this year's tumultuous events. People know how wrong this division is and actually want out of it, but they just don't know how to do it, says Carol Luckenmeyer, former executive director of the National Institute for Civil Discourse at the University of Arizona. I didn't know that existed. This article goes on to name a couple of practical solutions for how to maintain civil discourse, like listening to one another with an open mind and rather than listening with rebuttal in mind. But more so, it outlines some actual conversations and points of disagreements between the Mitchell and Gates families that they've actually had. And what I love about the article is that kind of between the lines is this truth that their friendship works because they choose to make it work. They love each other because they choose each other. In our gospel reading from the book of Matthew, the Pharisees ask Jesus yet another, it's a trap kind of question. Which commandment in the law is the greatest, they ask. And Jesus answers without even a breath of hesitation. He says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And the second, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus is not only Lord and Messiah in this moment, he is a talented public speaker and politician, I might add, at times. It's a Pharisee that asks him this, and Jesus responds first with a passage from Deuteronomy, something that the Jews called the Shema. He brings something deep from the heart of the Torah that is both beautiful and rooted, and then he simplifies everything else around it, all the rest of the commandments, into that vital second. Love God, love neighbor. In a time and place when 90% of people polled last year say that incivility is a problem, and in an era where love is more of a concept that is informed by Hollywood and romance novels and tabloids than seeing the work of love in action, maybe we could use some definition about biblical love that Jesus is talking about here. Debbie Thomas, who I seem to be quoting every week lately, she suggests that love is not a matter of personal affinity or a feeling or a preference. It's not a matter of lucky accident. It's not something that we fall into. But she says, love actually is a matter of obedience to the one that we call Lord. Love is a matter of obedience to the one we call Lord. And that got me thinking about love in the Bible, love stories. I thought about Rebecca, who agreed to marry Isaac sight unseen because she knew that God had ordained their partnership. She was so brave to travel into an entirely different land to become his wife. She chose him out of obedience to God and out of hope that God can do something with their love and life. I thought about Ruth, who commits herself to Naomi, her mother-in-law, during both of their darkest hours. When all was familiar was flipped onto its head, these women chose each other. They were each other's advocates and companions and schemers. I thought about Hannah, who wanted a child so badly that she went to the temple every day to pray. Her prayer turned from wanting a child of her very own to opening herself to being the mother of a child that would be God's servant and prophet. She chose to love and let go and let love grow and change inside her. And I thought about Zechariah, father of John the Baptist, who questioned God's working in his life, but he was willing to change and to grow because of the child that was placed before him. He was willing to let God move in his heart until he was both humbled and uplifted and awakened to God's work in his midst. Biblical love is vulnerable making. It requires trust. It demolishes expectation. It spills over margins and boundaries. And love takes effort and time and transformation and choice. And those are all things that I actively avoid on occasion, but it takes all of that. This call of love, this command of love, love God, love neighbor, takes all of that. When Jesus was asked that fateful question by those Pharisees, he could have said that the thing that matters most is that we believe the right things or that we maintain a personal or doctrinal purity. He could have said that we worship every Sunday or that we read our Bibles every day. He could have said that it's important to preach the gospel to everyone in every place. He could have said it matters that you never eat shrimp, but he didn't. Jesus didn't want our fear or repentance or our piety most of all. He wanted our love. And he wanted every single one of God's children to feel loved by us. Not ashamed, not punished, not chastised, not judged, but loved. In that Wall Street Journal article, there is an example of the Mitchell family and the Gates family defying the incivility norm. And this was the example. The subject came up once, soon after Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg died. The oldest boys, along with Bart and Chris, were in Virginia for a hockey tournament. Jill and Stuart were there watching the live stream of their game. And after the game, they started talking about the new nominee for the Supreme Court, Amy Coney Barrett. They talked about her stance, and they talked about her views on abortion, and they talked about how they're trying to do all of this kind of rush before the election. And Jill, who's a Catholic, opposed abortion but really supported that nominee. And Stuart, who was raised a Methodist, he was born and grew up in Brooklyn. And he was familiar with a time not long before when abortions were illegal and performed dangerously. "We were not coming from the same place," said Stuart. "But we listened, we had our discussion, and it was never heated, but when it was over, it was over." And the next morning, Stuart came over with a cup of coffee, we sat down together, and we watched the boys' hockey match. It's that cup of coffee the next morning. That's the choice. That's the love. You know, Christians have spilled a lot of ink on the topic of their debate and others as well, but it's the cup of coffee the next morning that matters most. In it, along with the cream and sugar, is plenty of reconciliation in that cup. Of reminding each other that they matter, that their relationship matters. You know, it's hardly a coincidence that Jesus links love of God and love of neighbor to each other, because each informs and revives the other. We cannot love God while refusing to love what God loves. And love in the Bible, in the biblical sense, isn't vague and disconnected. It's not happy vibes and kindness. Love is a choice to impact what is flesh and blood and tangible right in front of you. Love is robust and intimate and indigenous in a way that it is in your space naturally. But to do that in this era of wanting to be right all the time, it's bringing cups of coffee to your neighbor that you've had a disagreement with the next morning. To listen and respect each other, to let everyone be heard, to choose our neighbor. That sometimes, that effort, it takes God, doesn't it? Only God's love is inexhaustible enough to get us all through 2020. Another quote from Debbie Thomas. She said that the motion of our hearts must be cyclical. Love of God making possible the deepening of our love of neighbor, and love of neighbor putting flesh and bones on our love of God. The motion of our hearts must be cyclical. Love of God making possible and deepening our love of neighbor, and love of neighbor putting flesh and bones on our love of God. It's convicting. I'd like to close my sermon with a blessing from a Black Rock prayer book. And it's a benediction, really, but I want us to receive this as a prayer. So let's pray together. The world now is too dangerous and too beautiful for anything but love. May our eyes be so blessed that you see God in everyone. Your ears, so you hear the cry of the poor. May your hands be so blessed that everything you touch is sacrament. Your lips, so you speak nothing but the truth with love. May your feet be so blessed you run to those who need you, and may your heart be so open, so set on fire, that your love, changes everything around you. And may the blessing of our God who created you, loves you, sustains you, be with you now and always. May it be so, God. Amen. And now we have some special music. Here we go. Let's enjoy. That duet was beautiful. Thank you. All right, we're going to have a time of prayer for our congregation. Is there any names in particular that you would like to raise up today? Pat?
My sister Sue has COVID.
Mm.
My brother Kurt may have it. And his girlfriend Jan may have it.
Oh, man. We will pray for all of them today. Thank you, Pat. Peggy, you had one?
Paul.
Paul.
It's a cousin from Jews.
Hmm. Absolutely. We'll pray for Paul today.
Stomach cancer.
Stomach cancer. Yes, Cindy?
Our daughter-in-law
in North Dakota
is waiting for a test result on the
COVID. What's your
brother-in-law's
name?
Jesse.
Oh. Oh, okay, sorry. Daughter-in-law. Thank you. We'll pray for Jesse and the whole family as they await results. That's so stressful. Kristen?
Max Singer.
Yes. We'll keep praying for Max. Thank you. Phyllis?
My brother-in-law, Vance, out in Washington, is experiencing health issues.
That's Vance?
Yep.
Yeah. And I just talked to Jana yesterday. She says that Brad's appetite is back, which is great, but they are battling kidney issues now. And so please continue to pray for Brad and a myriad of fallout from his surgery. But hopefully he'll be home soon. Any other prayer requests for today? Then let's go to God in prayer. Like the Israelites in the wilderness, we too have seen your miracles and known your love. We too have wandered away and wandered back. We too have experienced your care, your provision. You invite us to extend that love to the world around us. Love God, love neighbor, you teach us. To care for others as deeply as we care for ourselves. And even deeper, to love as you love. And so we bring the needs of our world before you now. God, hear the prayers of this congregation today. We pray for the many who do not have enough food to eat or shelter to keep warm, enough employment to keep them going, money to pay their bills, enough medicine or medical care. God, we uplift many people that are resting on our hearts and minds today that are in need of your healing mercies. God, we pray for Sue, who has COVID, for Kurt and others who are awaiting test results, like Jesse. God, be with them as they wait patiently. God, bring them calmness of heart and mind. Bring them health, God, and protection. God, we pray for Paul, who has stomach cancer. God, be with him. God, we pray for Max, who also has cancer and has just started treatments this week. God, be with him. God, we pray for Vance out in Washington and Brad as he continues to heal from his heart surgery and keeps on top of his new concerns arising daily, it seems. God, be with their support systems and medical teams as they care for him, love him, and care for themselves during these tender times. We also pray for those who have more than enough, but still struggle to find meaning and purpose. We pray for those who have had more than enough of the noise and news of the day, for those who have numbed themselves from it, God, hear our prayers. God, we pray for our nation, for our leaders, that they might be protected from this coronavirus. We pray for our nation that we might be moved towards civility and love of neighbor, that we might be inspired by those cup of coffees the next morning after disagreements. Lord, strengthen us all in a manner worthy of the good news that we have received, offering our lives in service for your kingdom, where the last are first and the first are last, and there is grace enough for all. Lord, hear all of those unspoken prayers that swirl around this room today. In the name of Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Creator, Almighty, Lord, all of those other names by which we call you, God, in your name we pray. Amen. As we close down our worship service today, I invite you to stand as we bless each other in our sending blessing as found in the bulletin. Go to celebrate the God who is our home forever. God's love goes with us. Go to follow Christ's example in loving God, self, and neighbor. God's love goes with us. Go with the Holy Spirit to change the world with love. God's love goes with us. And I invite you to speak with me our church covenant. We covenant with the Lord and one with another, and do bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all his ways, according as he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth. Go now and be the church, for your work, your witness, your welcome is just beginning here and now. Amen and amen. Go in peace.